we work very closely with archaeological scientists here in the British Museum. And one of my colleagues, Dr. Aude Mongiatti, has been working on the Oxus treasure, which is a collection of about 180 gold, silver, and gilt silver objects that date from the 5th or 4th century BC.
Hi, my name is Aude Mongiatti and I'm a scientist here at the British Museum. I specialise in ancient metallurgy. And today I am studying some gold objects from the Oxus treasure. This is an example you have here, a gold roundel with boars and ibex on it. And what I'm interested in is understanding how it was made and also its composition. So I am using the scanning electron microscope, variable pressure scanning electron microscope, which allows us to study objects non-destructively and to analyze them as well. Here, I will now push the door. We can know the position of the object at all times thanks to the infrared camera within the chamber. And so it's actually ready now. So I'm able to switch on the high voltage, so the incident beam of electrons, onto the object to create an image. It should now be able, yes, there it is. We have got a first image of our object. Then we get to a small area and we get the image in focus as much as we can. We go higher in magnification. And then we can move on the surface of the object. This is an ear of one of the boars. Those long grooves are part of its mane. And this is the mane going through here. And what we are trying to look at is the type of tool marks that we can see on the images. And here, for example, we can see cuts which have been done in the mane, but the tool has actually gone further down. They're quite sharp angled. Other grooves, I think the ones which we can see on the ear, they're much smoother. And so the tool that has been used is most probably with a blunt edge, and it has been gently pushed into the surface of the metal to create the groove instead of cutting through the metal to do that. So this is the sort of features we're trying to look for in order to identify manufacturing techniques on objects. If I show you one of these gold armlets, this is a typical example of a cast. The casting method used is a well-known method for the period, which is lost wax casting. Some of the decoration has been added post-casting using techniques such as chasing and punching, which is using blunt edge tool to create the various grooves and patterns. Here is another object illustrating a different type of technique. It will have started with a little cast ingot of gold, but in order to create this roundel, make the shape and then decorate it, it's only hand working which has been involved. Again, chasing and punching, gently hammered from the back and from the front as well. So the scanning electron microscope, as I've shown, allows us to capture high resolution images, but it also allows us to analyze compositions. The SEM is equipped with detector for energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy, which allows for chemical characterization of a sample or an object. So this detector allows us to acquire spectra typical of the chemical composition of a sample or object. So in order to analyze, in our case we're looking at gold alloys, we first acquire an image of the area we're interested in. And this is relatively, you know, low magnification, it's 200 times, you can go much higher if you're interested in a single crystal or phase, as we call that in a metal. So once we have acquired the image of the area of interest, we can choose to analyze a whole area. This whole area inside the yellow square is being analyzed, but I can also choose to do spot analysis. So I've done four little spot analysis here. Then you want to have an idea of the chemical composition overall, but also each phase. And so while the spectrum is being acquired, you can watch it live and see the elements which are being detected. What we see here is the composition of the surface of the object. And in our case, we can see that there is a lot of gold with some silver and copper. What has to be borne in mind, though, is that due to various factors such as burial environment and or surface treatment applied by the goldsmiths, some of the alloying elements, copper and possibly silver, may have been removed from the surface. So it may be that in the actual core of the object, the silver and copper contents are higher than what we detect here on the surface. So yes, this is the final spectrum that you get upon doing chemical analysis. And then the software also allows you to quantify. So here I have chosen to highlight gold, silver and copper, which are the alloying elements for this alloy. And I can see that on my surface, on this particular object and on this particular area, there is about 90% gold, about 9% silver, and very little copper. So we get two types of results. The spectrum, where we can actually check whether the elements that the software detects are really there, and then the quantified and normalized results. What I found interesting is the variety of alloys which have been identified. For example, this particular randall, which looks a lot greener than the other gold objects due to its high silver content, it has got about 20%, shows that it's an unrefined gold used for this particular object.
We were really excited right from the outset to put the results of archaeological science in the interpretation of this exhibition. One of the most interesting things about this new research was the real proof of the level of skill and the variety of techniques used by the different craftsmen to make these different objects.